United States is under nuclear attack. Take cover immediately in your carrier fallout shelter. Repeat, the United States is under nuclear attack.
Asking the question now, are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
I believe I have the right to be confronted with any evidence which supports this question. I should like to see what you have.
Oh, well, you would.
Yes.
Well, you will pretty soon. The witness is excused. Impossible.
It's Don's house!
It's the witness' house! Let the camera kill you! It's Charlie! He's the one!
Hi guys, welcome to another episode of U.S. History with Lennox. During the 1950s, America was knee-deep in the Cold War, afraid of the spread of communism throughout the world. Well, that fear is going to spread to the American shores, and we're going to enter into what's known as the Second Red Scare, a fear that swells through America that communism is actually coming onto our shores. And it's not just within our government. We start to look for communist traits within ourselves. And this Red Scare is going to expand from the government to the people. So come on, let's go look at McCarthyism and the Second Red Scare. Now, as I mentioned, there was this widespread fear of communist influence throughout our country. And there were a lot of outside influences that led to this. The fall of China to communism, the first successful test of an atomic weapon by the Soviet Union. And on top of that, we discovered spies among us. And so what we start sensing is a conspiracy growing throughout our country. And this fear is going to lead to certain actions that not only start to step on our civil liberties, but also cause Americans to start turning against each other. Now, initially, the first thing the government was looking for was loyalty. The Taft-Hartley Act is one of those first key legislative processes focused on stopping the spread of communism. And where do they go? To the unions. If we go back to the first Red Scare, the unions were seen as possible breeding grounds for communist and socialist behavior. And so the Taft-Hartley bill is going to be created after we see this wave of strikes throughout the United States following World War II. And if you remember back to the first Red Scare, and we think even further back to the Bolshevik Revolution in the 19-teens, these ideas that led to all this started with unions and started with strikes. So what the Taft-Hartley bill did was it made closed shops illegal, meaning that companies could not limit their employment to union membership. It also made specific types of strikes illegal, wildcat strikes, solidarity strikes, or even political strikes. Now, President Truman actually vetoed this legislation, but we're going to see both Democrats and Republicans in Congress come together and override that veto. Also within the Taft-Hartley Act is what's going to be called loyalty oaths, where upon employment, you sign an oath promising that you are not or never have been tied to a communist organization. In 1947, these ideas are going to expand to employment in the federal government. Executive Order 9835 created the Federal Loyalty and Security Program, and it will require federal employees also to sign loyalty oaths. It also executes the power to investigate any federal employee and their political affiliations, not necessarily their ties to the Communist Party, but just their ties to any political party. This is when HUAC is created, the House Un-American Activities Committee. This is a committee within the House of Representatives that is going to start investigating individuals and their connections to the Communist Party. What they feared was that conspiracy I mentioned earlier, that there were spies among us. And there will be individuals who actually go on trial and are sentenced to jail or worse because of the belief that they were tied to the Communist Party. Let's start first with Alger Hiss. Now, Alger Hiss was a State Department employee. And not only was he accused of being a communist spy, he was also accused of being a spy for the Soviet Union. Now, he is going to come up in front of HUAC and will refuse to testify. In the end, he's going to be convicted of perjury and disbarred. He will also serve 44 months in jail. Julius and Ethel Rosenberg will also be accused of being Soviet spies. Now, the charges against the Rosenbergs are going to stem from an implication made by a known Soviet spy, Klaus Fuchs. Klaus Fuchs had actually sold American and British secrets to the Soviets to help them build their atomic bomb. He is going to claim that the Rosenbergs worked with him to make this happen. They're going to be accused of passing information to the Soviet Union about the construction of nuclear weapons. The Rosenbergs will be convicted and executed by the electric chair. Although a lot of people believed at the time the evidence against them was circumstantial. Now later, there will be information that actually points to Julius Rosenberg being part of this spy ring. A side note about HUAC is a member of the committee. His name is Richard Nixon, a freshman representative from the state of California. I want to introduce you to him here because he's going to play a role in the Cold War all the way through the 1970s, and he gets his start right here in the 1940s. It wasn't just scientists and politicians that HUAC was looking at. They also went west to Hollywood, and they're going to start looking at the message that Hollywood movies are starting to put out. And they see an underlying tone that could lead people to believe that communism was the right path. One of the most famous groups to be accused of being communist is going to be the Hollywood 10. These are 10 Hollywood movie directors and producers who were accused of spreading a communist message through their productions. They will be called to testify again in front of HUAC. They will refuse to testify and will be found guilty of contempt. Now, what's worse about the Hollywood 10 is what happened to them after the hearings. They will be put on a blacklist, making it near impossible to get a job in Hollywood. Because the bottom line is, you did not want to be associated with anyone accused of communism. And that's what started to turn neighbors against neighbors, is this idea that if you're a communist, I might be guilty by association. Joseph McCarthy is probably the quintessential representation of our government going after communists during the 1950s. So much so that we call this attack on people McCarthyism. He was a U.S. senator. During his re-election campaign, he is going to claim that he has a list of 205 employees of the State Department who were communists. This accusation and these claims are going to create a swell of fear throughout the government as well as the population of America. We didn't know who was on the list. We didn't know how that list was compiled. And while everything he was saying was unsupported, the fear was that there was these communists in the government and we might be accused of it if we're not careful with who we associate or with what we say. McCarthy is going to hold hearings that the Senate is going to back up, where he will bring people in front of his committee accusing them of being communists, asking them for proof that they were not communists versus providing proof that they were. McCarthy, though, is going to see his rise to fame under his fight against communists come crashing down in 1954 during what's known as the Army McCarthy hearings. McCarthy's going to go as far with his accusations as going to the U.S. Army and accusing communism within the ranks of our military. And during the hearings, which will be shown live on television, Americans are really going to start to see the bully that McCarthy really was, using this position to push an agenda of his own design. In the end, Republicans and Democrats are going to come together and censor McCarthy, saying what he has done is wrong. A censor is a congressional punishment, kind of like a slap on the wrist, but publicly, it's not a good look. And so his career is actually going to go down in flames at this point, and he's going to die several years later in ruin. But we got to look at what this Red Scare, what this fight against communism within our country did to our culture as a whole, because it had a very strong effect. We're going to see this climate of fear and repression start to grow in American society. We're going to see a lot of hysteria start to rise. And it's going to be fueled by the McCarthy hearings and also people like J. Edgar Hoover, who, as the leader of the FBI, is also going to start making a lot of the same claims like McCarthy did. And with regards to being accused of communism, it's not what they could prove. It was how you could defend yourself. You almost were guilty until you proved yourself innocent. And because of this, we're going to see our political climate grow more and more conservative. The left feared that if they didn't jump onto the conservative side, they would be associated with communism and therefore be found guilty of being communist, whether there was evidence or not. We saw alleged communist sympathizers have their lives completely disrupted. They would lose jobs. They would lose family members. And they would be blacklisted like we saw with the Hollywood 10. During this time, we saw our civil liberties decline. In the Supreme Court case of Dennis versus the United States, the Supreme Court ruled your free speech could be limited if you were accused of being a communist. People were being punished based on the political party that they supported. It had nothing to do with any of their actions. It was just about things they were saying or thinking. And that's what's scary about this time, that our fear of communism is going to drive us to a fear of one another. And you started seeing people accusing each other of being a communist, of not acting in the proper American way. And this swell is going to take us through the 1950s. Now, we will start to see it subside. But the idea that the fear of an idea led to the rights that we as Americans appreciate every single day be stripped away should have been a red flag for anything like this ever happening again. You have to decide. Is McCarthyism an idea that died during the 1950s in the Red Scare? Or is its foundation still existent in our communities today? Worth thinking about, right? Well, that's going to do it for this one. McCarthyism and the Red Scare. I hope you learned something. If not, you can always rewind it and watch again. If you liked it, give me a like and always subscribe. Tell your friends to subscribe. Get them all watching. But I thank you for watching. We'll see you on the next one. Bye-bye.